Welcome to the show known as Conversations with Ralph Walker. Have you circled the calendar? Do you know what's going on April 14th in the city of Monrovia? Election time. Election for mayor and for city council seats. KJM is doing something special and up close, and that's interviewing the candidates running for political office. Today I'm honored to have here in the studio Gloria Crutchington. Did I get that right, Gloria?
You did, Ralph. Thank you.
All right. It's a pleasure and honor to have you here.
Thank you.
To some of the viewers out there might say you're a familiar face. They've heard the name before. Give us a little background on your involvement in the city of Monrovia.
Thank you. My husband and I moved here in 1979. So we're very long-time residents. We started getting involved in the city really in 1988 when we joined what was then the Monrovia Old House Preservation Group, now the Monrovia Historic Preservation Group.
And what do they do?
At that time, back then, it was a group that was formed by mostly couples that had purchased older historic homes and were involved in restoring them. And there were a lot of us around at that time.
So what is the membership crowd like in terms of numbers? Is there a lot? Has it declined? Has it increased?
Currently, we have about 200 households. It declined for a while, but with recent activities in town, we've been taking an upsurge.
Okay. Have you ever ran for a political office before?
No, sir.
All right. Inquiring minds are wondering, why are you doing it now?
Well, if I might put in a little bit more background.
Okay.
We got involved with politics, not from the candidate side, when the city in 1999 started talking about developing the foothills and putting a lot of houses up there. In 2000, City Council decided to call for a vote of the people on what they wanted to do, and my husband, Cleve, and I decided to volunteer to run that campaign.
Was that Measure M?
Measure A and B.
Measure A and B, okay.
And it was a successful campaign. The citizens voted 79% to tax themselves in order to purchase the property. So at that time, we were then appointed by Mayor Bob Bartlett to chair, actually I chaired the Wilderness Preserve Steering Committee, and we were charged by City Council with prioritizing the purchases and finding other matching monies.
All right, so now did that halt development up in the foothills?
It did.
That was the purpose of the ballot.
Absolutely. We were able to purchase the land. I did some of the negotiating with the landowners and also was a member of the lobbying team to go up to Sacramento and look for matching money, which we were successful at doing. So once we purchased the land and the steering committee was dissolved, I was appointed to Community Services Commission in 2003, and I've been sitting on that commission ever since.
And what does that commission do?
Oversight of the Community Services Department, which includes all of the activities that take place in our community center, including rentals in the museum, all of the contract classes that go on in the community center, the after-school activities
so
in the
does
summer.
How does one get involved in that?
Well, if you want to take a contract class, you can go online, and we now allow you to register online to take classes.
I mean, to be a member of the, you're sort of like advisory board?
Yes. There's an interview process. It's a three-year term, and every year around May, there are openings. Sitting commissioners need to reapply when their term is up.
How long is the term?
3 years.
Okay, 3 years. So are you at the end of the three-year period, or are you just getting into it?
I think I'm year one, I believe,
okay,
at this time.
So now, to the voters out there, what is the issue, driving issue, that has you want to be in this race at this particular time?
Well, there were actually three,
okay,
and it all came about last year. I have been an activist for the Monrovia Historic Preservation Group. I was happy in the activist role and a lot of the volunteering that I do around town. But some things started happening that began to get me concerned. The first one involved the budget. A staff member suggested that, actually, this person literally said that the budget was a shell game. And that...
Meaning?
Well, I wasn't sure what it meant, and that's...
Three shells, and where's such a...
Where's the pee?
Yeah.
I guess. But, I, you know, I wasn't sure what was meant by that. So over 9 months, there were 10 meetings. They were conducted off camera before the city council meetings. I was literally the only member of the public that was there most of the time. It was mostly staff and city council going over the intricacies of the budget before they voted on it in May. So this was the run-up to
last May. So the public didn't know what was going on?
Well, they certainly noticed it. Okay. They gave the appropriate notice, which they have to do. But there was, unless you were willing to attend at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock before a council meeting, and made it your business to know when that was, it wasn't something that you could go on KGEM later and watch.
So the shell game. So what did you discover?
Well, what I discovered was that we had $38 million of unfunded deferred maintenance. This is projects that we know we need to replace or already needed to replace. Mm-hmm. And that since it was unfunded, the only thing that was funded through the budget was $300,000 for this past year, which I did the math sitting there, means that it would take us 125 years to catch up with all of that.
So why the stagnation?
Well, that's the $60,000 question. I'm not sure, but what it looks like, it's longer than just the recessionary period. The finance director told me that about 2 million of it was attributable to things that they said, oh, we just have to put this off. And what it looks to me like is that we do not budget for the expected replacement of things that break and wear out. And I'll give you an example. Because I'm on the Community Services Commission, we were very involved with Julian Fisher Park.
Yes.
When that playground equipment became unsafe and had to be removed, we hadn't been putting away a little money for that eventuality.
Well, it had very little upkeep over the years also.
Well, but nothing lasts forever.
Right.
And this isn't rocket science. You can kind of predict what the usable life of equipment is going to be. And if you and I know that we're going to have to replace a roof on our house in another 10 years or 15 years, then hopefully we're going to be putting a little bit away towards that eventuality, particularly if we're a city.
Well, now someone may be saying, well, the city prioritize what's important. What is the top things that a budget in a city the size of Monrovia, 5 items that should be a priority when you discuss the budget?
Well,
I'll give you one. I know one's got to be safety.
Absolutely. Yeah, our public safety employees are absolutely part of that.
Mm-hmm. And after that, what?
I would start listing a replacement of the equipment that the public safety people are using and the buildings that they're operating in. We certainly have to keep the lights on. We have to keep the water running. So we need other employees in order to do that. There are a lot of things, and a lot of it has to do with paying the salaries and the benefits of the people that work in the city.
So who's been the watchguard over this? Who takes the fall if it ain't working?
City Council. City Council's job, for all of us that are voters, is their job is to be good stewards of our money. and to provide oversight for the city employees. Presumably, city employees, including the city manager, actually the city council oversees the city manager. The city manager is in charge of the employees.
Well, sometimes the city manager is more powerful than the city council. Some cities have a powerful city manager that almost dictates to the city of this is what you need to be doing. And then sometimes the city council is powerful enough that they dictate to the city manager. I guess it may depend on
manager. Actually, the
personality.
Well, in this city, the rule is that the financial decisions made for the people are made from our elected officials,
which is the city council.
Absolutely.
All right. Now, who's your campaign manager?
Me.
One person. You're running and you're...
I'm the manager.
You're the manager.
I have friends that are helping. I have, a group of us.
So how do you go about getting Gloria's message out to the community that you're running for office and these are the issues that you want to focus on?
Well, the first thing I'd like to do is give you the two other issues I'm running on.
Got it. Good focus.
Thank you.
Okay.
So that's one of the things I have to keep focused. So the budget was one issue. I was concerned about this ever-growing amount of deferred maintenance that we're not budgeting for and that we're seeing the effect of on our streets. Mm-hmm. What I worry about is what we're not seeing the effect of, which is our pipes and our sewers and all that stuff. So that was one issue that I found unsettling. The next thing that happened was that I was at a Gold Line presentation, and staff was asked the question, didn't we get a grant to a large grant with which to restore our historic train depot that's going to be a centerpiece in the Gold Line station? And they said no. And that disturbed me because I remembered distinctly that we had gotten a grant. So I started asking city council members. I specifically took Mayor Lutz out to lunch to say, what is up with this?
Her response?
Well, sort of a shocked expression and not much in the way of words, which was sort of my response from everyone else. I didn't know what it meant. So I did a little bit more, but nothing happened. Nothing happened. So what I did then was I started doing some research, and I located in a blog an indication that someone had gotten a City of Monrovia newsletter with that exact information in it. And so I submitted a public records request for that newsletter, which said, yes, we got a $927,000 grant with which to restore the train depot.
Tell that to the viewers out there again. How much money?
$927,000 in a grant.
Where is this grant at now?
Well, when the public records request came back to me from the city clerk, it was accompanied by a note from then interim city manager Fran DeLash, who told me that the grant had been neglected, that we'd had to return the money.
Wait a minute. I know it's got to be a viewer out there that's saying, how do you let a grant, money you don't pay back, money that Monrovians probably put in, okay, because grants are from a wide variety of sources as far as...
Absolutely. They come out of our tax dollars somewhere, yeah.
And then we got that kind of money in this town where we don't need that type of grant?
Well, I certainly didn't think so. I thought we definitely needed that money.
So it was neglected or time elapsed, or what do you call neglect?
Well, since the then city manager also said to me that an employee was terminated at the time, it seemed to me like something went terribly wrong.
So, sound like
lack of oversight.
So is this person that was terminated, is this the fall guy, the fall person in all this?
Well, it would be the reason that I'm talking about this now is that I, like many people, would certainly like to get to the bottom of it.
So who would you hold accountable for this?
Well,
because you're running for office, and sometimes you have to truth to power can be quite challenging.
Here's where I am at this moment in time. That train depot has been the centerpiece of every rendering we have ever done on the Gold Line since we started to envision it. This is not a structure that you can forget about.
Right.
In all of these years of planning, I would have expected at some point a city council member or two would have remarked, so what's happening with the restoration of, how we doing on the restoration of the, they announced the grants, how we doing? How's it coming?
Where's this money?
Where's the money? Absolutely. And the fact that that didn't happen is one of the reasons that I'm running. I just am astounded by this whole event.
Does that fall on the whole city council? Who does it fall upon?
Well,
the buck has to stop somewhere, right? Where does the buck stop at?
I think we need to have a full discussion about this in a public forum before we can answer that question.
Well, we got elections on April 14th, so guess what?
Well, there's going to be an opinion cast about that, I would hope. So here's another issue that I have is that the city did release a statement through our current city manager saying that the process had been deliberate and thoughtful of just letting go of this grant. But what I hadn't released to them yet was that the note I'd gotten from the interim city manager stated that somebody had been fired. So how deliberate and thoughtful can an action to lose a grant be when someone is terminated?
Now, how have you gotten this word out to the voters? Do you think they're aware of?
Well, I wrote a letter to the editor in Monrovia Weekly, and there has been some response to that. I have included it in every mailing that I've done to my first mailing, which was really to supporters of mine.
And what's that magic number, 925? What did you say?
$927,000. Oh, but wait, Ralph, there's more. I think that this is going to be the beginning of looking at a number of grants that have been lost, have been neglected.
More than just one?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Let's talk about the Gold Line. What impact will the Gold Line, that station, have on Old Town?
Well, hopefully we will be able to do something with probably Proposition C transportation dollars. We'll probably have to reprioritize some of them and hopefully create a rectangle of vans or trolleys or something along those lines.
Well, you know, they say the biggest challenge is to get Californians out of a car. How are you going to get somebody out of a car to get on the bus to come up to Old Town? That is a tremendous challenge.
You mean from the train station?
Yes.
Well, from the train station, if we have a trolley or something that goes on a north-south line on Myrtle, and then maybe another one that does a rectangle on, say, Huntington and Fifth and Mountain and Foothill, then we can do two things. We can bring people down to the station out of the neighborhoods without having them get in their car to get to the train station. And if we've got that north-south connection, then we can take people out of the train station and we can move them up into Old Town.
Okay.
Well, or if they go off on Huntington, then we can get them to Huntington Oaks. We can get them to some of the hotels. We can get them to other restaurants. There are different places.
All right. What's missing out of Old Town? If you had to bring two business to Old Town, what would they be?
Well, I'd like to think about that more specifically because I think this is part of a bigger picture that has to do with a plan that we need.
Mm-hmm.
And the plan that we need has to be seeking businesses that are complementary to the stores and the shops that are already there as opposed to competing directly with them. We have a lot of stores downtown that have been loyal, mm-hmm. that have made it work through tough times. And the last thing we want to do is be bringing other stores into town that are going to undercut their business. So I think we need to focus very directly on what that would be and then go out and see if we can find a match for it.
Even though business can get ugly that way. I mean, prices go up. Those that can't afford to rent, they have to leave. Some people sell.
But downtown is the heart of Old Town. Yeah. Without those business owners, our heart is gone. Mm-hmm. One of the things that makes us unique and charming as a town is that historic downtown. The communities around us that don't have one envy it, and I don't blame them a bit.
The reason why I say that because of Station Square.
Right.
The business that's comes into that area is going to be, quote, new. And everybody looks for, quote, new, even if they're just passing through. They want to go check it out. So that can create an economical drain one way, whether it lasts a long time or not. That's for us to see.
But, and you know, it's a democracy. You know, we can't control
right.
everything, nor do we want to. But on the other hand, I think with some judicious planning, what we can do is that we can ascertain what would add to the mix as opposed to detract from other people's business. I mean, the history of Monrovia shows, you know, there's such a thing as too many bars downtown.
Yes. Yeah.
So, you know, we can learn from our mistakes. And there was one more issue, speaking of quaint Old Town and
yeah.
our historic structures, that I wanted to bring up, because this is the last reason that I decided to run. And it was last October, I started getting calls from members of the Historic Preservation Group that were terribly upset about a structure that went up.
McMansions? Are we going
there? McMansion, absolutely.
All right, define to the viewers out there, what is McMansions and why are they a detriment to a community?
Well, a McMansion is a relatively architectural, styleless, massive structure whose main function is to increase square footage, sellable square footage on a lot, without regard to its impact, mass-wise, on the neighboring structures or the neighborhood.
So how do you respond to someone that says, hey, I spent over $2 million to buy this house, and I don't have the right to knock it down and put up the structure that I want?
Well, no, you're not allowed already to put up just anything you want. We already have zoning ordinances in place.
Well, how did
and
some
they can
get
be
up
changed.
There then?
Well, what we're looking at now is neighborhood compatibility, because property rights are important. However, we've got a lot of neighborhoods in Monrovia, one kind of neighborhood which I'm going to call historic, where we've mm-hmm. got 50% or more pre-1940s homes. And part of the appeal of why people move to Monrovia is that quaint, charming look that we have.
Mm-hmm.
If they want to move to Arcadia, they move to Arcadia.
Maybe they can't afford Arcadia. Maybe Monrovia is the spot, the sweet spot for them.
But Ralph, the people that are making the money off of these houses are not our residents. They're developers right. who are doing this on spec. It's an investment for them. And yes, of course, they want to maximize the amount of money that they're making off of. But and I must say that the developers that we have in town that are long-term developers have, because of the zoning codes, have been restraining themselves tremendously. It's not them that are a problem. It's more of a fly-by-night, doesn't live here, doesn't care
All
about
right, now,
the impact.
In your campaign, have you been knocking on doors? What would you say to someone that lives on the other side of Huntington Drive? What would be your message to them to make them want to come out and vote for you?
Well, a number of things. Their streets and infrastructure are affected by what's going on now. They have a different issue with neighborhood compatibility. Down there, the zoning will allow for what they call planned unit developments. And there have been Some of those that have gone up, like, you know, 4 cell blocks in the middle of single family homes. And they lose their, could lose their view, they can lose their privacy. And people have been showing up from all areas of town to the Planning Commission about this. It's not just the historic neighborhoods, now, it's everyone's neighborhood.
Should there be a park on the south side of?
Oh, absolutely.
Long overdue?
Long, oh my gosh, as a community services commissioner, this has been the focus. And the hope was originally, had the Gold Line station looked the way we had originally envisioned it, there was going to be a lot more room for open space down there than there is now. And that's just a crying shame. But see, I don't think we should give up. There are new vehicles that are coming online to replace redevelopment agency. For instance, infrastructure districts. The city of Los Angeles is thinking. Oh,
they're telling me the hands of time is moving fast. I have to jump onto something else as fast as you can answer it. And that's the voters. How are you getting them to come to the polls? What's your message to get them out there to make them? Now, did you take out a statement in the booklet for voting?
Yes.
$1,500.
Yes.
Quite a bit of money, right?
Well, actually, when you consider how expensive it is to reach voters, it's the bargain. It's the cheapest way to do it. You'll get that pamphlet in every home. And in answer to your question, what I'm doing is I'm sending out mailers that are primarily educational pieces to tell people about the issues that about the grant, about.
All right, you can save that thought because you can look in that camera right there and tell the voters out there why they should vote for you on April 14th as you seek one of those city council seats.
Thank you. I'm hoping that after listening to me, that you find that what I've had to say has substance, that it resonates with issues and concerns that you have. And on that basis, I am asking you, please, on April 14th, to vote for Gloria Crudgington for City Council.
All right. Thank you so much, Gloria. I wish you the best.
Thank you. Okay.